Hello. Hi. Thank you for coming. This is very exciting for me. And every year, I have to admit, I start to experience kind of like a progression of dread as this event gets closer, not because I don't look forward to it, exactly because I get nervous, I get butterflies, and I think, why did I agree I was gonna do this again this year? And usually it's once the conversation gets going on stage and I start to feel like, okay, now I remember. But actually, somehow tonight, just it's as soon as I saw these two faces, I just felt, oh my God, this is gonna be so fun, so exciting. So it's gonna be very fun, and thank you all for coming. In the film, a couple of things just leaped out. I haven't seen that before. And one thing was, someone said it's a gift. A residency at MacDowell is a gift. And that is indisputable. And it's because I was given that gift so many times, and it was so crucial, so invaluable to my work, that ultimately I got to a point where, well, the point was when they called and said, will you be the chairman of the board of directors, I had to say yes. And a lot of you probably had heard me say this before. I felt I had absolutely no choice because I owed such a debt. And I didn't know how I would ever be able to repay it. It didn't even seem possible. Being chair has not only been a fulfilling and satisfying experience for me and taught me to do things that I didn't think I could do, but it also has begun to give me a chance to try to repay that gift in some way, which doesn't ask to be repaid because it is a gift, and a gift is its own fulfillment. The other thing that you heard was that people get a lot of work done while they're there. And what I wanted to start out by asking you guys about, now Ta-Nehisi is a MacDowell Fellow. He has been in residence at MacDowell. And we're very proud of that. We had Ta-Nehisi before he was Ta-Nehisi even. The Ta-Nehisi he is today.
Or rather, when I was Ta-Nehisi.
Yeah, exactly, when you were still Ta-Nehisi. And Lena, not yet, but we would love to have
you.
It's
a goal.
Okay. What I would like you to do is just start out, okay, let's say you're going to MacDowell next week. Just all the things that would need to happen in your lives, I magically make those happen. So whatever. Dog care, child care, all those things, forget that. That's all taken care of. You're going to MacDowell next week. Ta-Nehisi, what would you work on when you got there?
Wow, that's a deeply weighted question, because I feel like there are things in my heart, and then there are things that need to get done.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess in terms of what's in my heart,
yes,
it's actually the book that I started at MacDowell. I should preface this. Michael, I don't think Michael actually knows this, but Michael, he was very kind, because my family came up and, you know, they, for I don't know, whatever reason, invited us to, you know, come and stay with them at their vacation place in Maine. And I brought my family with me, but I also brought the manuscript that I had started at MacDowell 2 years earlier I had been working with. And Michael has this beautiful studio. I'm sorry for blowing up your spot. But
that's all right.
both him and I yell at have these, you know, two beautiful writing studios out there, which they made the mistake of telling me about and saying to me that I could go to at any point. So I was not the most social person for the entire time. Mm-hmm. I was there, but it was one of the most happiest times of my life. And it's, you know, similar, you know, at MacDowell, I think, like, for all of us, and Lena, I don't know if it's the same for you, like, there's work that you just deeply, deeply love, you know, that where you feel, I mean, sometimes when you're in it, where it's like, I don't even care if any of you guys ever see this. Like, I actually don't. It's actually that pleasing to mm-hmm. me to create that. I realize that I have not actually named what that work is.
Yes. would you care to?
Yeah, I would care to. it's a piece of fiction that I started about an interracial family in the era just before the Civil War and the antebellum period. And I started that at MacDowell. That was 6 years ago. And I have a draft of it that, you know, if I had my druthers, I would be working on right now, and, you know, would be finished right now. Every time I go back to it, every time I just finished a big piece of writing for The Atlantic, and every time I, you know, finish something and I go and I go back to that world, I feel so at home. It's like the book looks at me and says, where have you been? We've been mm-hmm. waiting for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's probably what I'd be doing.
Well, that's what MacDowell's there for. It's there for the things of your heart, the projects of your heart. So, you know, we're there for you, Ta-Nehisi. Just say the word.
I need to make that time.
We'd love to. And Lena, so would it be the same for you? Would you try to sort of knock off things you have to do, or would you try to do something you want to do?
I mean, my answer's shockingly similar to his. I think this is a really complicated and exciting, but complicated moment to be anyone, mm-hmm. but to be an artist, because there, as you said, the work that you feel has to get done, the work that you feel is expressive of where we need to be moving societally, the work that we feel is responding to the circumstances that we find ourselves in, which are specific and which are dire and which need our attention and which need creative voices. Mm-hmm. And then there's something that almost feels like selfish about returning to the work that is so personal and private. And of course, I would argue that, like, you know, the book Ta-Nehisi's describing sounds like it probably needs to exist and would help people see the world in new and profound ways and would soothe their fears. Mine wouldn't do that. So
I don't think it would, actually. I'm not sure that it would. I can't say that.
Well, I definitely can say that mine will be helpful to no one in that regard. And so, but I want to work on it all the time. Mm-hmm. And so it's actually, my fiction book is due at the end of January. And
whoa.
And so I'm in. And I'm
why
in
are you here right now?
I know. It's shocking. And like my writing habits are like despicable. And like it happens like in the middle of the night and at mm-hmm. like in long like non-eating bursts. And I have not yet learned to like treat it like an adult job, even though it's an adult job. So mm-hmm. I think something that would be magical about going to a place like MacDowell would be to erase the things that make your writing day frantic and tortured, and to create some kind of schedule, which I've never actually been able to tap into. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wrote my last book like literally at night while I was shooting my television show, or like on Christmas while ignoring my family. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. And so I think mm-hmm. it would be an amazing thing. That sort of uninterrupted time would be incredible. But there is also, I think we all feel this, like every day that I don't like engage the news and sort of like fight the good fight, there's this feeling of guilt. And I think that everyone has to start thinking about their own creativity and their own self-expression and their own internal life outside of what's happening mm-hmm. in America at large is like sort of also an essential part of the political climate, and also super important because it's keeping us healthy.
Mm-hmm. Well, so if you, and I'm glad you mentioned that, and I want to get to that subject of just what we can do, what all of us can do, what artists can do. Before we get there, just I'm wondering, so if you're imagining a trip because of your work habits, and you mentioned you get distracted by other things, what would you have to take with, are there things you would need to take with you to sort of create the space, the proper, what you think is a proper space for yourself to get your work done in? Are
you
fetishistic about certain kinds of pencils, like Stephen Sondheim? My first time we did this, it was Sondheim and Paul Simon, and Stephen Sondheim is very particular about his yellow legal pads, and they have to, if I'm not mistaken, they're yellow, but they aren't legal. They're 8.5 by 11, and then certain kind of pencils, and that's it. That's all. I mean, do you have those? Are you crotchety?
No, you know what? I think if you left me on an island with my iPhone, I would write in the notes.
And the notes app.
Like I was just, you know what I mean? I don't have time for that.
Until your battery died.
Yeah, it's gotta get out. But I just wanted, it's very important what you said, that thing about work that we feel in our hearts would not improve the life of anyone. Because I actually think sometimes that's the most special work. Like that it only, you know, matters to you. I was at this thing, I had to do this thing earlier today with these school principals. Why?
Ooh. Whoa!
But see, why anybody would invite me to talk about school? I mean, you know, I just don't. Mm-hmm. I don't quite get. But you know, there I was. And you know, it was one of the guys. He said, you know, what did you want people to get out of, you know, out of your book Between the World and Me? And I said, you don't understand. Like, I wasn't thinking about that at all. Mm-hmm. Like, I had a feeling I was trying to express. And so, what political good? Or what good it would do to what? I had no idea. In fact, I was pretty sure it wouldn't, because it wasn't a book about solutions. Da, da, da. I'm not trying to talk about Between the World. I mean, what I'm trying to say is I think like preserving like that thing, that happiness is like really, really, like I think that's exactly right. You know, and if I may say so, like I think that's the thing to go to MacDowell for. Like, mm-hmm. regardless of what, you know, good it's gonna do these people here.
That's comforting to me. I'm going to listen to it. I am. No, I like work on my laptop in bed, like with a heating pad. Like, I'm telling you, mm-hmm. it's the like my writing behavior is deplorable. My boyfriend is here; he can tell you it's like hunched over like a monster with like food in the bed. Like it's not. I have like a beautiful office I never enter. Like it's just not. It's not mature, and it's. I mean, I think probably I would just like fill that cabinet McDowell with just like I don't know like. You know, like underpants and crackers. I guess. But I do think that what would be, I mean, you know, there's a certain amount of work that just goes into like, I mean, it's not like, I mean, it's like I'm in New York, like really so distracted by like the party scene mm-hmm. that I can't write. Like it's more, it's just that like the work that it takes every day to get all the things that we've obligated ourselves to done, whether mm-hmm. they're personal or professional or whatever, it's just like, being a grown-up is so hard.
Yes, it's very true. Do you has there been a point in your life where you, I mean, you're almost done with this book. So, is it all been done in snatches? Have you found time to make space for? Is it utterly impossible for you to make space for because of all the things you've got?
Well, it's like, I don't mean to be like, I've got so many jobs, like, but I mean, shooting a TV show is a very, very mm-hmm. specific, mm-hmm. rigorous schedule, and it keeps you busy all year round, and there isn't really a day that you're not thinking about it, and we're sort of approaching the end of it. We are just locking the final season of the show, and so there is going to be this space, and I'm going to be, you know, editing the book from a very different place of not having to return to those girls' characters and not sort of being worried about. I mean, I was constantly like with my last book going like, did I already write this into an episode? And what's even happening? And mm-hmm. and but no, this book has been written in you know after work in bed and in moments on weekends and you know like in a corner on a trip. Mm-hmm. And I wrote a bunch of it in Japan when we were shooting girls there, and I wasn't mm-hmm. directing or acting. I was just producing, so I had this time to steal away. And I have to admit, I have guilt about that. Like, there's a part of me that sometimes feels as though because I wasn't sort of, like, in a room of one's own environment, that somehow it doesn't count as real writing, that it's like I just wrote a blog that nobody saw or something. Not that a blog isn't real, but, you know, I just, like, mm-hmm. it feels almost like tweets I wrote in my room or something, and I have this, I have a real feeling of imposter syndrome around it, and I'm hoping that the editing process is going to help me feel a little bit more solidity in what it is that I've made, but... That's not how I felt last time, so probably won't feel that way this time either.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, that's exactly what, I mean, you hear from these people, and when you're at MacDowell, and I've heard so many stories from artists who found that just even knowing they got to go to MacDowell and spend time at MacDowell was such a, felt like such a vote of confidence in their work than what they were doing, and that it was worth, at least as far as the MacDowell Colony panels are concerned, it was worth the time to bring this artist here. It can be something that really transforms an artist's life. I wanted to ask you, I was thinking about trying to come up with some kind of question to ask you about early influences or important people, people that you couldn't have been sitting here tonight without. And then in reading up on you guys, I just noticed that the name David Carr appears in biographies of both of you. And so you have at least that, if not certainly many other things in common. I just want to ask you, can you talk about David Carr and what he meant to you and what he meant to you, Lena?
You mean without crying, right?
Mm-hmm. If you can.
That's a roughie.
We started this conversation upstairs, and for your benefit, we cut it off. How do I put this? when you're young, at least when I was young, you know, basically three sources of self-esteem that you had. You could be a great student, you could be a, you know, great athlete, or you could, you know, be, you know, very good with the opposite sex. And I guess, you know, in this, mm-hmm. you know, world of acceptance that we thankfully live in now, you know, same sex. Mm-hmm. When I was a kid, it was, you know, the strictures on that were much, much stronger. But the point I'm trying to make is I was not good at any of those things. That's the thing to understand there. I wasn't. I was a very social kid. I had a, you know, a lot of good friends. I was, you know, relatively well liked. But, you know, as you know, the notion of how you were going to be anything of any value to the world. And, you know, growing up where I grew up and how I grew up specifically, how you were going to live, how you're going to make it, you know, past age 30 was deeply, deeply tied, I would say, mostly to school. You know, and if you didn't have school, you really needed to have those other two things. You know, I had no idea what was going to become of me, but I'd been writing all my life, you know. I'd, you know, been listening to hip-hop, you know, writing. I had been, you know, my mom used to make me write these dumb little essays when I would get in trouble. Mm-hmm. So I've been doing that. You know, I'd, you know, been scribbling. I've been trying to write really bad Lord of the Rings sort of fantasy novels. You know, so I had been writing all my life, and I, you know, did some amount of writing when I came to college. And David Carr at the time was the editor of the local alternative newspaper in D.C. And I was about 20 years old, and I knew someone who was working there, and they said, you know, they have an internship there. You should send some stuff. And I sent this chap book of, oh, my God, just awful. What we used to call kill whitey poetry, you know. Just the worst. Mm-hmm. There's about three people in here who know exactly what I'm talking about. But it was, you know, just this book full of this awful, awful, and love poetry too, which was, if you can imagine, actually worse than the kill whitey poetry. But just the most didactic, you know, stuff you ever want to see it. But I sent it to him, and you know, this guy, this actual journalist, read it. I was like, wow, I think you have some talent. So he calls me and says, you know, you should come in. You know, and he comes in and, you know, he brings me in for the interview. And David was, I'm sorry, I got David stories for days. But David was just off of crack and he was just off of alcohol. And David would tell you about it and it was very loud about it and was completely uncouth and had no sort of style in the sense that we recognize the idea of it. But he was one of the most honest people I had ever met in my life. And this was immediately apparent to me. And he loved in the way that I identified love at that time, and I guess I still identify today, and that is to say he was very, very hard and very direct and very honest, and if you did something great, you were God to him, and if you did something horrible, you were the dirt beneath his shoe. You know, he was extreme. He was crazy, but he was the kind of crazy that I could understand. Mm-hmm. And so me, you know, being just out of, you know, West Baltimore and having literally no social relationships with white people at all, like none, and having walked into City Paper, which is at that point virtually a completely white environment, and trying to just figure out all sorts of cultural things. The thing I had was I had David, you know, who, you know, like I can remember years later coming to New York and failing, you know, just flailing, as a journalist, and you know, him being this, you know, huge, huge big shot at the New York Times, and he would call me up and he would say, Coates, what are you doing? I want you to come to lunch with me. Mm-hmm. You know, and he would take me to these fancy lunch places, and I would come home and I would say to my wife, what is this white man doing? Like, why is he spending this much time? You know, around me. And he just invested. I mean, this is like, you don't understand, like before all of this, like I was somebody, like I really was somebody. And I was actually the same person I am now. And there was every incentive in the world. And there were all sorts of forces in the world that was, you know, telling me, you really need to go do something else. Mm-hmm. And David was, to a large extent, the only great and powerful force that was saying, everything else that you're hearing is completely wrong and I'm right. And if you believe, you know, in me, and how could you not, you know, believe in David because he was so brutally honest, you'll get there. And it kills me that he's not here right now. It kills me. He got to see some of this, but he really, like, I went to accept the National Book Award, and I'm like, how is he not here? Mm-hmm. You know, how is the only dude, you know, accepting, and I'm, you know, I'm holding it back here, accepting, you know, like, you know, my family and the people who were close to me who knew, how is the only dude who looked at me when I was 20, you know, and had none of this, who watched me get fired from jobs and laid off and treated like complete shit, like not here. Hmm. I mean, it was, it's a horrible loss. I mean, people often, you know, say, I would not be here without such and such. And that's a kind of euphemistic. I'm telling you, this was literally true. Like, this was actually true, you know, of David. And, you know, I was telling Lena upstairs, I mean, he would just, you know, in the last couple of years of her life, he would just brag about her. I mean, I'm, you know, I'm talking before, you know, New York Magazine and before everyone's talking about girls. I mean, he would just brag on how, you know, big she was going to be. He, and I'll cut it off right here, but he had this wonderful ability to not be afraid of young people and to just completely and totally invest in young people. Just a great human being, great human being. Thank and you. It's a huge loss.
Thank you. I'm going to cry.
I mean, it's interesting because it's like obviously we have very different stories and very different histories, but everything that you're saying, everything that you're expressing about him and the way that he encouraged you to stay true to your identity and encouraged you to keep working when it didn't feel like there was a space for you, I mean, that was everything that he gave to me. I mean, I met him because I was at South by Southwest with my movie. No journalist wanted to talk to me. Nobody wanted to talk to, like, you know, someone was like the 23-year-old, like, chubby girl who'd made this movie about her parents or whatever. I mean, it was just not a conversation. And I remember when the head of the film festival said to me, David Carr saw a screener and he wants to meet you for dinner. And he came and, like...
Did you know who he was at that time?
I did. I knew who he was just because I knew who he was from his byline. And I was, like, sort of shocked. And he had been the carpetbagger and I was, you know, obsessed with, like, Hollywood everything. So he was, like, a real source of information, and he met me in the lobby of this hotel, and I have to admit, at first, I was, like, scared of him. I was, like, because he had scary and this really super weird physicality, and, like, the kind of person who your parents kind of tell you to, like, cross the street to avoid. And then we sit down and start talking, and it was just, like, I couldn't believe how much he understood what I was trying to do and how what a feminist he was and what a powerful thinker he was, and... I mean, if he hadn't written that article about the movie, it wouldn't have gotten bought. It wouldn't have gotten seen. Nobody at I mean, it's not an exaggeration to say, like, no one at HBO would have paid attention to the film. I wouldn't have my career. And then from then on, he was one of my best friends. And there was, like, no reason in the world that, like, a 23-year-old girl who is still living with her parents should be incredibly close to a 50-something recovering crack addict who was, like, incredibly honest about his sobriety and, like, incredibly, like, brash and, like, vaguely inappropriate and, like, but he was just, like, he was pure love. And it's also true that, like, when I fucked up, he let me know that I had fucked up. And that's when you know that somebody's, like, not there because people are starting to care what you do. He was, like, there to keep, it was like I was, like, a balloon and he was, like, holding on to the string. And I've actually never even said this, but, like, I mean, we had such an intimate email relationship, just emails and emails, and he was, you know, such a beautiful writer and so casual in the way that he put words together. And after he died, like, I was actually, like, of all weird things, like, filming an episode, a cameo on Scandal, and I found out he died. And I was supposed to go on set in this, like, fucking horrible wig and do this, like, scene in which I was like, I admit it, he raped me. And I was like, I can't do this. And I was, like, crying really. It actually ended up being maybe okay because I couldn't stop crying in front of the whole cast of Scandal. And then, like, it was interesting. I was like, I don't know. I was like, I need to let the director know, like, why I'm weird and why I can't remember my lines and why this is going on. But it was like there was no way to properly convey the relationship because it was like I was like my friend died, but it wasn't like I could express the extent of the...
Like, the whole reason I'm here right now talking to you just
the whole
the
reason
earth.
You wrote me this cameo is because of this person, and he's not here, and I don't understand what's happening, and it's hard when you love someone. I had the same experience with my friend. When you love someone who's a public figure, and so you see that they're dead, and it's on Twitter, and you can't even, like, you're like, that's not true, and, like, for weeks until they shut down his Times email, I just emailed him, like, every day. And I was like, I knew that he wasn't getting them, but they were just, I was sending them. And actually, like, that became a habit, because then when my uncle passed away last year, I started sending him emails every day that were just like, just checking in. And I was like, I know I'm not reaching this person, but this was our form of communication. And I'm just so happy that I got to see David a few, I saw him about 2 weeks before he died, and we had this just beautiful time, and he was happy and he was excited, and I'm sure you knew this about him, like sometimes he loved his job and sometimes he would go like, I hate it and print is dead and I want to bust out and maybe I'm going to write a movie and maybe I'm going to start a public radio show and I don't know. And like, he was just in his life and loving his life the last time I saw him, and that felt like a gift to get to see that.
Yeah, no, he was, he was extraordinary. I mean, and I think like the way he took interest in you is just not... It's just not surprising. I mean, it's just really, really not surprising. I mean, he had gotten so much and yet did not seem like caged by it, you know?
No. And I also have to say, just because this is true, he's like the only person not related to me of that man of that age who ever took interest in me and never then hit on me.
But you know, I heard you were saying how he was a feminist, right? And he was the fairest... See, there's a lot of people who talk the race or the game. And David didn't know nothing about no trigger warnings or privilege. Mm-hmm. That wasn't how he talked. But it
David
was like,
said a lot of very offensive and inappropriate things all day long.
He was. But he had it in his bones. Do you understand what I'm saying? In a way that, like, I don't need you to police your language. I need you to get it in your bones. Mm-hmm. Like, in your heart.
His daughters are two of the most incredible women in the world, not because he raised them with, like, some kind of, like, gender theory, but just because he raised them to be like, fucking go, do it. Like,
just because he treated them like humans, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like a basic sort of.
I mean, I'd be like, how's Aaron? And he'd be like, she made this movie, it sucked so bad, I had to tell her. Like, but then he'd be like, she made this thing and it's per, and I mean, one of the most heartbreaking things was his daughter made this incredible film for HBO that he had started to see and was so proud of. And it was like, she did it, and she did it like, she, as he would say, she really did it up.
So, can either of you imagine for us what his take on the current situation and how he would be
having a ball? Oh my yeah. god!
Yeah. He lived for this shit.
Oh,
like,
man.
I mean,
Jesus.
Yeah.
He would. This would be his moment, right?
Mm-hmm. He would also love it because there's nothing like David loved to be like, I'm taking down these people and it's dangerous, but I'm going in anyway. So it's like he'd be like on Steve Bannon and. Like changing, getting burner phones and fucking with people.
He had this insane sense of like, and if you ever see like that Times documentary and you see the part where he's writing about the Chicago Tribune.
Oh my God, I remember when he first started that and he was like, I'm onto some shit, Lena.
Oh my God.
And he was like, and we're taking down something big. And I was like, I felt like I was in a movie, and he was like, and don't tell anyone. I was like, I don't even know how to describe what you just said to me, so I can't tell anybody.
No, he had this, behind all of that, you know, Lena's right. I mean, this was a white dude, like the whitest, dudest of, you know what I mean? All the things you think you don't want in your Afram studies or your women's studies, like that was how he presented. But he had this like righteousness, like this kind of John Brown shit where he was like, you know what, you know, I'm gonna go. And I have to, you know, I worked for him, which
sounds terrifying.
I mean, I worked for this dude, and I think like he was just like, go, you know what I mean? Like, if I was you, I would be going, doing X, Y, and Z. I was on crack. How dare you come in here and talk, you know what I mean? And not, you know, talk these stories about what you didn't do today or what you couldn't get. I don't want to hear that shit. Go get it. And so, like, I went through that for 4 years, best time of my life. And after that, you know, he was just like with any other struggle I had in my life, he was like, no, I know what you're weak at and I know what you're good at. You know, these people are full of shit. Mm-hmm. I know. And I believed him because I knew everybody else I worked for, you know, they couldn't hold a candle to him. Mm. You know, so I knew that he had to be right. I mean, he just instilled this kind of faith. And if he were, Lena's right. I mean, he would be all up on Steve Bannon. I mean, he really would.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. And he'd be calling shit out, and he'd be going and finding his fucking daughters and interviewing them and trying to figure out what would happen. I mean, he would be like...
It's a huge loss.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a huge loss to journalism. And I also think that, like, there's a way... I actually thought about this a lot, that all of us who were so surprised and sort of so, like, those of us who had the privilege to be surprised, which is many people, and then I talked to many people who were like, yeah, welcome to another day in American history, you fucking idiot. Mm-hmm. And... Mm-hmm. But I do think that David would have seen, because he was such a student of media, would have seen the writing on the wall before a lot of other people and either gone like, here's how we can turn this ship. There's times I've wondered, like, would he be like, here's how we can turn this ship around? Like, there's time, like, I really think he had powers that were very great.
So let's talk about that. Ayelet, who's sitting here in the front row, a classmate of hers at Harvard Law School, Norm Eisen, who became the U.S. ambassador to the Czech Republic under President Obama, had the opportunity when he was first ambassador to meet and speak to Václav Havel. And Havel, this is 8 years ago, it feels like even longer, but it was a long time ago, and Havel said to a group of Americans, be careful. The kind of thing that we got rid of here, that we freed ourselves from here, can happen anywhere. And I just want you to know and always remember that it was artists, writers, musicians, and greengrocers who made it happen. Now, we don't have the discipline of being a greengrocer is not one of the MacDowell traditional. We don't have a panel, a greengrocer panel. Maybe we should.
But you do have fresh eggs.
Yes, we do.
I was really excited when you told me there's no cafeteria. Having to go to a cafeteria with people was a huge turnoff for me. And once I found out that the eating was private, I was like, all in.
Well, it's not exactly
private. It's family style dining. Yeah. It's just no cafeteria. Oh, I think it's cute that you thought it was a cafeteria.
I thought it was like there was like a buffet and like you had to like wait with a tray. And then when you said
there
was
kind of is a buffet. Mm-hmm.
So, but you're saying you have to eat with other people.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, you do.
Fuck. Okay.
No, that's actually one of the best parts. And that's the inspiration for this very evening is the kind of way that people talk to each other on the dinner table.
Okay.
But you're not, it's not obligatory. You can stay
no,
and like eat cup of noodle in your studio.
I don't
you become that
girl.
Uh-huh, exactly.
Lena's too good to eat with us.
No, I'm already that person, except like nobody understands that I'm just like crying and clutching my uterus. They think I'm like off doing something sexy and snobby.
Well, actually, you make a good point, and I think, you know, I could make a case that we could try to create some kind of panel and program for something like greengrocers, but we don't have that yet. But leave that part out of the equation. But I mean, it's a very comforting notion. It's sort of a flattering notion to think, well, artists have a role to play, or there are things artists can do. I would like to think that art has power and art can change things. But is there more to it? I mean, also, I'm not going to argue with Václav Havel, but what do you think, or what is the role right now and going forward, let's say not super long term, but just into the shorter term, relatively speaking, that do you think artists have a different role to play, or should we all just be doing the same things, and what are those things?
You know, I'm deeply skeptical of art's ability to change. I feel like whether things, and this is, you know, really guided, you know, through my experience as an African American and an ancestry and a history, you are, you know, talking about a group of people who were enslaved for 250 years and have been free for 150, which is to say they spent more time in, you know, North America enslaved in chains than they did. And each generation of people hoped for freedom. And what they got was more slavery and more slavery and generation and generation mm-hmm. of slavery. And yet people struggle nonetheless. And so like often what I think about is, what if you can make no difference at all? What if there's nothing? What's your responsibility then? Hmm. And I think whether you can change things or not, like that does not relieve you of responsibility. Hmm. I think you have to fight, you know? And I think you have to fight because I think there is something beyond change that can be affected. There is the idea of what you live for, you know, and I have to tell you, you know, as terrified and as horrible as I, you know, think the, you know, events of, you know, the election were, I live for this moment. This is a great time. I mean, this is, you know, when, man, I had it in my head. I had spent 8 years writing about the president, you know, in large respect, that was going to be over. Hillary was going to win, and then maybe I could sit back and think about other things I wanted to do with my life. And it became clear that I could not, you know, and that was a beautiful thing because it reminded me that, you know, it just, and I don't know if this is a horrible way to think about it because people are going to suffer. Let's be very, very clear about that. This is a bad thing that happened. But I'm just talking about for me personally, it filled me with so much energy. You know, I felt I've felt in the days, you know, I have all these people who I run into who are depressed, and I was down at the Atlantic, and the young people say, oh, this is awful. I said, what are you talking about? This is your time. This is the moment. You know what I mean? This is when you, you know, totally, you know, feel it. This is what we live for as writers. And I just, I had, you know, I was in this place where, you know, as a result of Between the World and Me, I was getting all these other opportunities. And I had to call them one by one and say, I can't do it. I can't do it now. And remember that this is my lane, that I'm a writer. You know, and what I do is I make books and I make articles. Those are the things that I do, you know. And now I have a formidable opponent. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's a way that that can just make you, you know, it fills your life with meaning. You know, I was telling Lena, you know, my wife, you know, Michael, as you know, she's in med school, and the whole thing that, you know, put her in the med school was, you know, for years she volunteered, you know, on behalf of reproductive rights and various organizations, you know, dealing with that sort of thing. And there was a court case that was very, very encouraging that came down early this year, and we were really, really happy, and we had spent the year in Paris before, and we thought, oh, man, maybe we can actually go now. You know what I mean? Clearly the fight's over. It's done. Mm-hmm. And then this happened. I said, well, you know, this is the war. This is why you're there. This is why you're alive. This is why we need you. And so as perverse as it sounds, you know, as absurd as it sounds, man, I'm excited. You know, I'm ready to go, you know. This is, you know, just a return to everything that, you know, my ancestors, you know, not to, you know, be too melodramatic, you know, but this is, you know, the entire fight that my ancestors have, you know, been waging for hundreds of years in this country. So I'm happy to be, you know, within the tradition and, you know, back to the business. It's what it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I definitely had similar. I worked on the Clinton campaign for 18 months. I worked on the campaign before she even announced that she was running. And it was a huge part of my life and a huge educational experience. And I kind of like to use a sports term I don't understand, like kind of left everything on the field. I just gave it everything that I had. And I didn't just believe in the idea of having a female president. I really believed in her. And I really had to, I mean, I woke up the next morning experiencing an incredible amount of grief. And at first it wasn't even grief for this country. It was grief because I was like, that was her job. Mm-hmm. She worked for 30 years. That was supposed to be her job. And it was just the heartbreak of knowing that was never going to be her job. Mm-hmm. And then slowly I started to, you know, awaken to the realities of what this was going to mean for women, what this was going to mean for people of color, what this was going to mean for undocumented people, what this was going to mean for, you know, for trans Americans who are, my younger sibling spends their entire life fighting for, you know, imprisoned trans people who were, you know, living with, you know, the hope of being able to have their, you know, their gender reassignment surgeries paid for by the government, and now every single thing that they've pushed for is in peril. And so once that became clear to me, I realized, I mean, I had the same thoughts of like, Hillary's gonna win and we're gonna celebrate and all of the people who've been torturing me on the internet for 6 years can fucking suck it and we're gonna have the best time. And then that's not what's going to happen. And I do have this feeling, which again, I don't mean to sound melodramatic, which is like, I've had horrible, I mean, what we once called the alt-right, what I guess is now the right, has been a source of torture since the moment that I came into, I mean, unspeakable, both behind and in front of the scenes, acts of cruelty towards, I mean, I was 23 when I started this job, and it was like old white men fucking with me harder than you can even believe. And that was, David was a huge source of support and comfort, and I realized if I could withstand that, and if I could withstand that sort of intellectual bullying and that sort of like terror activity and the attempts that they have used to silence, you know, I mean, if they're trying to silence like a little rich white girl, what are they doing to everybody else? And so there's the part of me that's scared, that wants to disappear my name and just, you know, hide for 4 years because, you know, Breitbart spent 6 months trying to prove I wasn't raped. What are they going to do when those people are in the White House and they have access to your fucking email? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I had this realization that was like strong, like stronger than me, which is I was like, I don't want to have to go down for this, but I will. Like, I don't want to have to, like, I want to protect my family and my relationships and the people I love. But if what has to happen is that, like, you know, I get, you know, metaphorically strung up by my toes because I think that we were all born equal and beautiful, then that's just what's going to happen. And I know a lot of people who are going even harder than I have the bravery to do. And whatever way I can do that, whether it's through my writing and making people feel normalized, whether it's through social justice activity, whether it's through giving a bunch of money to organizations that they don't even want to have exist, or whether it's just saying, like, these guys are rapists and monsters and racists and anti-Semites and they're running our country, but they are not the majority. I mean, that's that's our job, is to say that loudly until they're gone.
Thank you. That's right. All right, well, I thank you. I feel very inspired and very motivated, and I try to remember that all of the things that I'm most proud of, that make me, have always made me feel the most proud to be American, are always the moments in our history where, you know, from the abolition movement to women's suffrage to the labor movement to the civil rights movement to the things where we had the clearest enemy, where the adversary was sort of the most unmasked, and where, you know, people really rose to the occasion to fight. Those are the things that make me proud, as I think you're right, this is our moment. I'd like to now turn to you guys and see if anyone maybe has a question for our guests, or a couple of questions.
Oh, hi, Betty Goudreau. I'm a board member, and I love MacDowell. I have a question. You're both writers. I was at a discussion group this week, and it was about no truth in news anymore, and not being able to believe what you read, sometimes what you see. How do you feel about that as writers? And how can we cure this or get people to know what is truth and what is fiction that we are reading in the news?
Well, I think Ta-Nehisi is better equipped to answer this than I am as a journalist. But I will say one thing, which is we're finding out more and more that people don't care what's true and what isn't. Mm-hmm. And that is the scariest thing. It's like, you know, Hillary Clinton had a tally on her website of the amount of times Donald Trump made up facts during the debates. You could go and you could just see, like, false claim, false claim, false claim, false claim, false claim, and nobody gave a shit. Mm-hmm. And it extends to, and it's like, everybody knows that Keeping Up with the Kardashians is staged and nobody gives a shit. And so the fact is that what we have to understand is that people care more about being entertained and about being spoken to in a way that's sort of like pleasing and supplicating to them than they do about, it's like, they don't want to know the truth. So that's, like, to me, the bigger issue to combat isn't, like, which newspapers are, you know, newspapers of record and which websites are fabricating news that travels. It's like, how do we appeal to the parts of people who, how do we appeal to, like, an America that wants to be spoken to like intelligent citizens?
Yeah, and I think, like, it's just, like, really, the two parts. I think Ling is exactly right about the very sad thing is what I think we're realizing as a country, or as, you know, writers, artists, whatever, is the limits of truth. And I hate saying it this way, but there's really no other way, you know, to put this. If you're African American, you always knew that was true. You always understood that was true. I mean, it because it is the notion of truth, and lying is always key to oppression. Mm-hmm. You have to understand that. And so, like, if you're you know, in this room, there are people in, you know, who the era of Jim Crow is within their living memory, and Jim Crow was an era that was backed, you know, not just by a few mean people in the corner. I mean, if you research lynching, I mean, newspapers are deeply implicated in that. So it's, like, really important to remember that there is no golden past to appeal to when, you know, truth was, you know, more evident and was more. There is a period when there were, you know, a smaller group of people who had authority, you know, and had, you know, command over what, you know, what information would be disseminated and what would not. But it's not like that period didn't have its problems too. And I'm not convinced that it had less problems than, you know, to today's period. I mean, again, you know, if you read some of the newspaper coverage, you know, around, you know, lynchings and stuff, it is deplorable. I mean, it is, you know, absolutely, absolutely incredible. I mean, you want to talk about people making up information. I mean, you're talking about, like, literally the sort of conspiracy theories that, you know, those of us who read the New York Times sort of laugh at, actually in the New York Times. Mm-hmm. Or in the, you know, whatever the local paper is that's like the New York Times. I mean, that's where that sort of stuff, you know what? So in this sense, I mean, like I was saying before, we're back to it. I mean, we're just, you know, we've invented new technologies to do, you know, new sorts of things. But I don't know how much has changed. In that sense, we're confronted with something, with a deep sort of almost existential problem about humanity. If people don't care about the truth, to what extent is it up to right-thinking people to steer folks towards a more, you know, moral or just path? You know, it's very, and this is, you know, one of the reasons why I'm saying I'm skeptical about the ability of artists, journalists, et cetera, to actually influence opinion, because I don't know that it's up to us. You know, I just don't. I mean, one of the disturbing things about, you know, just studying African American, and I'm sure this is probably true if I looked at advances across the board in any sort of oppressed group, what you find is when there are advances, it's usually because something exterior happened, something bigger happened. And so there's no way of understanding the advances of, say, the civil rights movement without understanding the Cold War mm-hmm. and Russia's attempt to embarrass the United States. There's no way of understanding abolition if you don't understand, in fact, that the union of the country, a larger thing beyond the mean interests of, you know, African Americans or the moral, you know, rightness of the cause was actually at stake. In that sense, it's our job to, you know, disseminate information and be truthful ourselves. But, you know, in some sense, you know, we have to sort of accept the reality or the possibility, maybe not the reality, and a large swath of the country is not particularly looking for that or concerned with that.
No, and then you also end up sounding like, you know, like the town fool in a Shakespeare play who's screaming about the truth. And it's like a lot of homeless people who stand in Times Square are right about everything that they're saying. They're just like, and that's the thing that's hard. Like, I remember after some of those debates, like when Donald Trump described late-term abortion as like sometimes you pull the baby kicking just hours before the moment it was meant to be born. And it was like, I could have gone on Twitter and ranted about that for 48 hours, but the fact is, it's like, yeah. And then you're just that like crazy lady spitting food in everybody's face at the party, and nobody wants to listen to her, and nobody will listen to her. And so it's like, there is a bit of like a almost like a waiting game you have to play for the truth to prevail.
It's like you could do that, but that what is underneath of you doing that is the idea that if I give you information that is truthful and verifiable, you will accept that. But there's plenty of evidence to say that that's not,
that's
you know what I mean? Like, you're speaking French, and they're actually speaking German. You know what I mean? Like,
and also, everybody goes into every conversation. Most people go into most conversations having already decided what they're going to say and what they're going to hear.
Mm-hmm. And think.
Mm-hmm. Which is why it's so fun to talk to people.
Especially relatives. Mm-hmm. Maybe one more? Do we have two more? Time for two more questions, according to Dean Klingler, who knows everything. Yes, at the back.
So one of the things that has interested me most about both of your work is the way in which you've actually taken your life or your life stories and transformed them into art. And so this question of sort of truth in life is actually your work, right? And maybe that's, Michael, why you asked the question about politics in this sort of very open way, because I think the way both of you have continued your artistic journeys is as a voice, as just your personal voice reflecting. And I'm curious about how the discipline of art is something, or I'm trying to think about how do you hover on that line between just being yourself and having the conversation with yourself that you need to get outside of your own head and actually making a work of art?
Well, it's, you know, I was thinking just as you used the word discipline, I just want to be clear. My writing habits are not very different from Lena's. It's so funny because I just finished, like, we have this third bedroom, so I, you know, we got this standing desk and I got this beautiful iMac. And I was listening to you talk and I was like very afraid that I would never use that room.
Because get ready.
I've invested quite a bit in it. But, you know, no, I'm very much, you know, it, when I heard the word this one, I was like, oh my God. You know what I mean? So I'm very much the same way. I don't know. I mean, maybe you give this more thought, but I just feel the need to say things. And it doesn't really advance much past that. You know, for Between the World and Me, I had a friend who died and who was killed in 2000, shortly before, shortly after, I think, my son was born. And I was very angry about that for a really, really long time. I talk in the book how when 9/11 happened, I was completely cold and had no sympathy for anyone. You know, least of all police officers and five, I just none. And I was deeply, deeply angry about it. You know, I was, you know, telling Ira earlier about how I repressed, but it was there. I was repressed, but it was there. And I really, really needed to find some sort of way of understanding my friend's death. Not one that would make it okay, not one that would, you know, turn it into a fairy tale, but one that would just allow me to understand. I needed to do that. If only two other people read the book, I needed to do that. If it was only me and my editor, I still would have needed to do that. I don't have much beyond that. You know, I don't have much, you know, thought, you know, about how it's done or you know, who's going to see it beyond that.
I think my story is really similar. I mean, my book started from a place I had just finished shooting the first season of Girls, and I basically had, I guess, what I understand now to be like a nervous breakdown. I mean, I wasn't like doing anything that would, I mean, how scared were you guys, Mom and Dad? They were fine. They were used to it. But it was definitely like,
it was sort of a this sort of.
In the truest sense, it was a nervous breakdown. Like, I was nervous for people to see what I had made.
It hadn't come out yet.
It hadn't come out yet. And I was I was just starting to do all the press that was surrounding the show, and I felt paralyzed, and I felt, for the first time, just like the crushing. Basically, it was like, I'm sure all of you have had moments like this, like the pain of everything that you've ever experienced in your life that has hurt or formed your identity, like all hits you at once. Everything that you've sort of like segmented and all, you know, like it was like, you know, being chubby mixed with my grandmother dying, mixed with being sexually assaulted, mixed with getting dumped, mixed with fighting with my mother. And it was just like this one impossible to separate massive ball of yarn, and the only way that I could see out was just to start writing, and that's what the book was. And it was a way to process pain, and it was a way to process fear, and it was a way out of this sense of paralysis. And that's sort of how I've always experienced writing. And at its best moments it gives you joy, but also sometimes at its best moments it just like rescues you a little bit.
Yeah, you know, I do these things now, and people, you know, we have this new language, and they say to me, how do you get your self-care? Like, you write things that are so painful, but what's your self? It's the writing.
Yeah.
The writing is, what do you mean? What do you
self-care is a big
writing
one these days. Like, everyone's always like, what are your self-care tools? I'm like, I don't have any.
I don't have any. All right.
I write, and I hate being alive. What do you want from me?
No middle ground. No middle ground. No time for anything else.
Yeah.
That's all there is.
Thank you. last question, one last question, and then we'll say thank you to our wonderful, beautiful guests. Anyone? I can't really see. I'm pretending I can see, but I can't really see. All right, well.
It's cool if no one has another question.
Are you going to waste that opportunity?
Oh,
really?
Come on.
All right, so.
Uh-oh.
This question isn't fully formed, so bear with me.
We're great with that.
I've been trying to write something for a very long time. All of my ideas are scattered around different notebooks, phones, website, apps, Google, iPhone, whatever. And I've been struggling with a way to combine it all so that I can actually get, you know, like a working frame for the storyline. Any of you have any suggestions on how I do that?
Yeah, I think I have a pretty good one, actually.
Hey, take it.
So right. So what you do is you get your phone, and you get your pad, and you get your, you know, your little files, and you, you know, you figure out what format is best for you. Maybe you like being on a phone, maybe you like being on a computer, maybe you like being on a pad. You pick one of those and you put it all in the same document, and then you print it out and you look at it. Mm-hmm. And after that, you know, you can decide, you know, thematically, you know, what, you know, is ringing true across the board. But the thing that I found, that I wrote this piece years ago for the New York. It's my first time really writing anything for the, you know, long for the New York. And I was so excited and nervous, and I turned it in, and my editor got back to me and he said, you know what I think you need to do? You should put everything in order. Like, this happened, this happened, this happened. Now, see, you laugh, but it is, oh my God, it's the greatest advice. And it doesn't mean it stays in order. It doesn't mean it stays in order. But chronology, this happened first, this happened second, this happened third, this happened fourth, is deeply clarifying. It's deep. I mean, it's, you know, not to go back to this, but only because it's the freshest thing in my mind. It's what happened with Between the Worlds. I mean, I wrote it like one time, wrote it a second time, and then the third time, you know, second time, it was not a book. You know, it was a collection of thoughts. And I printed all of that out, and I literally went paragraph by paragraph and numbered where they were in the chronology. And then went and typed that up, like took the hard copy here and typed all of that up in order and looked at it. And lo and behold, I had something that actually resembled a book, even though that wasn't a book. You know, it is amazingly, amazingly clarifying.
That's really good advice.
People pay like $35,000 a year for literally the advice that he just gave me. It's great. Like, if you're still in school, drop out. You have what you need. We already know it's not going to get you anywhere anyway, so this is great.
I don't have anything to add. Thank you. Thank you guys
Thank
so much.
You. Thank you.
It's been wonderful. Thanks to all of you for joining us. Thank you.